Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the 2014 Husky Hall of Fame ceremony. Tonight's MC is a seven-time Emmy Award winner, a 1977 graduate of the University of Washington, and he was inducted into the University of Washington Hall of Fame in 2004. Please give a warm welcome to your host for the evening, Como's Steve Poole.
Go Dogs! It's good to be home, even though I didn't go that far when I graduated. I have been looking forward to this night ever since they asked me to do it, because this means so, so very much to me. My parents, when my dad got out of the Army, they made a decision about where they wanted to raise me and my sister. We had the choice of the entire country. And we decided to come to Seattle. Now, there's two reasons for that. The first reason was we had heard so much about the welcoming climate that is here in Washington for people from all over, so to speak. I'm not talking about the rain part. That's another whole deal, okay? But the other thing is they were very interested in getting their son and daughter a great education. When I graduated from high school, I had a number of choices on where I would apply to go to school, and I had a teacher who was pushing me to go, well, why don't you should apply at Harvard, you should apply at Yale, Stanford. Not! But it was then that I realized that one of the best institutions in the entire country was right in my own backyard, the University of Washington. I applied and I got into the school. I was absolutely delighted and ended up being the first person from my extended family to graduate from a four-year college with a degree, going all the way back. But when I was at school and I graduated in 77, there was something else going on here that was truly remarkable. That period in Husky athletics was, I think, a watershed. Because what happened was, well, two things. First of all, we had the arrival of Don James. Yes. Secondly, we had the arrival of an African-American quarterback by the name of Warren Moon. Don James took a big risk in the 70s and put Warren Moon in as a starting quarterback. With a lot of people, that wasn't real popular, but it turned out well. And for me to be a part of the University of Washington, watching us beat fourth-ranked Michigan in the Rose Bowl was an absolute watershed event in Husky athletics. We have to agree to that, right? But not only that, and this is my point here, when I saw Warren doing that, and I saw the way this university supported an African-American athlete, it made me think, well, you know, I'm not an athlete. Well, I tried in high school, but I was, I had a bad combination. I was too small and too slow. That's not good on a football field, all right? But I did realize that, wait a minute, maybe there's other things that I can do that might be in some way groundbreaking. And I ended up being the first African-American weathercaster west of the Mississippi when I was hired. But the reason why I tell you this is because these are the reasons why I'm so immensely proud of saying that I am a University of Washington Husky. Because what this university did for me and is done for all of us. It is truly a great, great institution. So we're gonna have a lot of fun tonight, and we're gonna meet some really incredible people and renew some old friendships, we hope. So, to begin with, I wanna welcome back all of the Hall of Fame members, the alumni, the current student athletes, and of course, all of our generous supporters. We are here tonight to honor some of the finest and most decorated Husky athletes to ever wear the purple and gold. Introduction into the Husky Hall of Fame is the most prestigious honor the University of Washington Athletic Department can bestow on a player, on a coach, or an administrator. We are here tonight to celebrate both individuals and teams and to present them with their very own purple jacket. So, to get started, we want to acknowledge the people that make this happen. I mean, these things don't happen in a vacuum. People work very hard on this, and of course, you need a sponsor. So to that end, I really want to acknowledge and thank you, the folks from Airvan and the Galvano family. Thank you so much for your support. Where are you? I know you're out there. Thank you so much for your support. And I also want to thank the folks at El Gaucho. Thank you. Are you out there? Thank you for your support. We have some special guests here tonight, and I get a little bit emotional when I talk about this guest that we have, because her husband and I ended up being great friends, and I can't tell you how many rounds of golf we played together. He was the most amazing man, I think one of the most amazing people I've ever met. One of our special guests tonight, please welcome Carol James, wife of the legendary Don James. We love you, Carol. We love you. I also want to acknowledge the Hall of Fame Selection Committee, also Dave Terrell, the Hall of Fame Curator, and Marta Valdez, the Hall of Fame Design. Now, ladies and gentlemen, here we go. Please welcome out our most distinguished guests, current Husky Hall of Fame members from various induction classes. Now, here's what I need you to do, because I've got a list of them here, and we're going to bring them up. But I need you to hold your applause until we get them all up here, okay? Or, you know, we'll be here till midnight if we don't do that, all right? So here they are, ladies and gentlemen. We begin the evening with the individuals, and I'll go right through the list, and they'll come right up. First of all, a member of the 1983 and 1984 women's eight that won the national championship, Eleanor McIlvaine. Oh, come on, that's worth a little more than that. National champion, you know? A member of the 1981 and 82 women's eight that won the gold at the Women's Collegiate National Rowing Championship, Peg Achterman. A member of the 1982 and 83 eight that overcame a new distance in bad weather, sorry about that, to win the national rowing title, Julie Baker. We also have with us a member of the 1975 mile relay team that came out of nowhere to win the NCAA championship, Jerry Ballour. A 1953 football All-American and the first Husky to be named Lineman of the Week by Associated Press. Please welcome Milt Bohart. Holding three national doubles titles and was the first Husky women's player to reach the quarterfinals of the National Collegiate Tennis Championship, Trish Bostrom. The UW men's tennis player who holds the single season singles victories mark at 39 and earned an All-American title in 1993, Chet Kriley. In 1990, he was the nation's top running back and the inaugural winner of the Doak Walker Award. Most recently, his name has been placed on the 2015 ballot for the College Football Hall of Fame. Please welcome a buddy, Greg Lewis. He was named first team all-conference in both 1959 and 1960 as a key member of the 1960 National Championship football team, Don Makita. This two-sport athlete is one of only six unanimous All-American selections in UW football history, Lawyer Malloy. What's up, buddy? As a track and field head coach, he produced 39 conference championships, 18 NCAA champions, and coached 10 athletes who became NCAA record holders. Ken Shannon. In 1963, he set the world and American record in the long jump at 27 feet 4 inches, defeating Olympic champion Ralph Boston, Philip Shinnick. He led the nation in passing his sophomore year, took home honorable mention All-American honors, and appeared on the cover of Sports Illustrated, Sonny Sixkiller. What's up, buddy? A first-team All-American linebacker in 1982 that set the UW singles game sacks record and fumbles caused in a single season, the amazing Mark Stewart. This head coach led his 1959 baseball team to the school's first NCAA regionals, E. Dale Parker. The captain of the 1959 baseball NCAA regional qualifying team that was just one game short of the College World Series, Jerry Thornton. An All-American defensive end in 1964 and a 29-year coach of the Washington football team, Jim Lambright. UW's first All-America tennis player and the 1970 team captain, Dick Knight. A three-time first-team All-America All-Pac-10 pitcher with six career no-hitters and the first Husky pitcher to amass 100 wins, Jennifer Spidiacci. An all-coast linebacker and guard for the Huskies, named the all-time San Diego Charger. Please welcome Chuck Allen. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, please join me in welcoming the current owners of the prestigious Purple Jacket. Let's do it. Thank you, gentlemen and ladies, so very much. Fantastic. Now, my friends, to begin this evening, we're going to be honoring an individual with a very special award. It's the Dr. Don L. Palmer Award. Now, the Palmer Award is the Big W's most prestigious award, and joining this year's inductee with the Big W director, John Otness, will be up here. John Otness, here we come. Along with our winner, which I'll tell you about in just a second. Now, this award recognizes and honors those who have exemplified a special commitment to the University of Washington Athletic Department. Tonight, it's my honor to present this award to a Seattle legend and a dear friend, of the University of Washington. He's on his way up right now, but let me tell you about it while he's working his way up here. I'm talking about Stan Pocock. For more than 50 years, the Pocock family has built the finest racing shells the world has ever seen, from the UW campus just steps away. Originally the exclusive property of UW coach Hiram Conabear, who used the boats to dominate from Montlake to Moscow, Pocock shells became the standard for nearly every major college club and National Rowing Association in America. A Pocock shell is as ubiquitous as the Louisville Slugger is in baseball. Stan's legacy lives on not only in the boats that bear his name, but in the hundreds of young rowers, including many future Huskies and U.S. Olympians, who have benefited from the George Pocock Rowing Foundation, which was established by Stan in 1984 to promote the growth of rowing throughout the Northwest. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in presenting Stan Pocock with the Don H. Palmer Award.
Okay, now after hearing all that, I can hardly hear what I'm going to say. First, however, I want to introduce my wife, Suzanne. The best thing that ever happened to me was when I married her. She is the greatest supporter of mine. She never rowed, which was one of her attractions, because I could go home and talk about something else beside rowing. But we have lived now for over 22 years, and we still find life wonderful together. I have other friends here, family, my sister, my little sister. I can remember when I became aware of her living with us, I felt like I had to protect her. And even today, that's the way I feel about her. The others at our table are my daughter, Sue, and my grandson, Chip, and my granddaughter, Stanny, who was named for me. She's Stan Jr. and I'm Stan Sr. The years go by too fast. I first remember being around the shell house when I was about four. My grandfather and my uncle had built a boat that the Huskies took to the IRA in 1913, and they won that race. So rowing was a big thing around Seattle. I have a clipping from the Seattle Times in which it announces that I had been born, and the article said that proud parents hope that this young boy will grow big and strong enough to row on the University of Washington crew. Well, that was a long way in the future. Actually, I did get pretty strong and not tall enough, really, but I actually did make the varsity in 1947, and we didn't do all that well, but I came back to Seattle, and the head coach, Al Albrechtson, asked me if I would coach the lightweight crew. I really didn't think I should, because I thought coaches were like God, and I didn't see myself that way. But I talked to my dad, and he said, why don't you give it a try? You might like it. Well, I discovered I did like it. I was able to help those young men learn something about watermanship, which they had never been taught before. And it made their turnouts somewhat more interesting for them. Because I worked them very hard, I knew that I had to if they were going to win their races. Then when I stepped up into the frost job, I was fortunate enough to have a lot of very good oarsmen, none of whom had ever rowed before. And that was wonderful because then I didn't have to unteach anything. I could teach them using a clean slate. And so we were able to do some very good. Well, we won some races. We didn't win them all, but we won more than we lost. Then I was sure that I would never coach anymore. And then some of the graduates came to me that I had coached and said they wanted me to help them train for the trials for the Pan American Games. So I did. I go out early in the morning with them and late at night and work in the shop during the day. And we went to Chicago, no, to Detroit, and they did well. And so in the Pan American Games in 1959, they did very well. Then they came to me and said, we want to try for the Olympic trials. And I said, God, I don't have time to do that. I'm trying to build boats. They said, but we really need you. And so I agreed to that. And as a result of that, they won all the events they entered at the Olympics, at the Olympic trials. And then we went off to Rome. And in Rome, you're like sticking your head in a buzzsaw because you meet the best of the best in the world there. But our coxswainless four won. And my cox pair ran into the buzzsaw and were lost to a Russian crew and a German crew. Both of them were really good. So then I knew I was through forever. And then some of the boys came to me and said, there's a world championship being held in Prague next year. Will you coach us? Well, I said, well, I guess I'll have to. And so I did, and we took 2-4s to Prague. But we didn't do well there at all. In the U.S., you only really train hard if there's a big thing coming up. In Europe, they train hard every year. And so we did not do so well. Well, then I knew my coaching of rowing was done. And so my name was stuck on some of the entries as being their coach, but I was a coach in name only. But they were people that I had coached, so they retained some of the things I had taught them. Then it was some years later that I agreed to coach women. These were older ladies who wanted to do something that their husbands had nothing to do with. And so I coached those for several years. And we went down to the Masters Championships in Austin, and they did well. They won a couple races, they lost some. And then that was all. I was going to build boats. And so I did.
You did, and you did it very well.
Well, you want me to quit?
No, I'd love for you to keep going.
Okay, I'm going to keep going. When you get me up here, it's pretty hard to stop me. Anyway, I do want to add in that I think that women's rowing was the best thing that ever happened for rowing in this country. Not only did the young men start showing up again, but they were so dedicated in their aim to become champions. I should add that champions are not taught. They're born. The only thing a coach can do is teach them how to row well. So, you're gonna stop me now, huh? You better, because... No, I have not. So I'm gonna stop, but by golly, I'm gonna read something here. And it's an experience that I had when I was turning out for the varsity, and I wanted to tell you about it because it was the best thing that I remember ever happening in a racing show. So I'm going to read it. It was late in the fall during my senior year. We were on our way home from a long row down Lake Washington. It was cold, dark, quiet, with not a breath of wind to disturb us. Al's launch was off somewhere with the other boats, We were alone in the world. As we skirted the shore to head westward toward the shell house, I saw looming behind us a full moon, awesome in its majesty, rising above the Cascade Mountains. I'm sure the others in our boat saw it, though not a word was spoken. Our boat was going as it had never gone before, steady as a rock, not a sound to be heard, save the gurgle of the water under the keel and the sound of the puddles made by our oars. An unspoken ecstasy experienced by all of us in the boat. I soon found that I was tired no longer. The harder I drove my oar, the greater was the joy of it. Could it possibly happen for just one more stroke? But it did, and then again, and again, and again.
So, Stan,
too soon.
You got, how many more pages?
They're right there. That's right there.
Oh, it's right there.
Too soon. We reached the float. Dead tired, we crept out to put ours away and carry our boat into the shell house. There was not a sound other than our coxswain's hoarse commands. Quickly, I dressed and left for the long walk up to my fraternity house, alone with my thoughts. I sensed that I had just experienced something that would probably never happen again. I had lost myself, and in the process, had truly found myself. I had had a brief glimpse of the divine. I had seen the me of me's, which was my soul. And that's it.
Congratulations. Thank you, Stan. Wow. Are you ready to go? All right. Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. The heart of our evening. This is truly an exceptional evening. I mean, we're surrounded by the who's whose names are commonly characterized with things like most decorated, the fastest, the most dominant and dual sport athlete they've ever seen, a visionary, a national champion, and even an Olympic champion. So let's get started. Our first inductee tonight is a true champion, an ambassador of Washington rowing. Anna Mickelson is one of the most acclaimed rowers in the pedigree of the Husky rowing program. She's in a league of her own. Let's take some time to relive some of Anna's accolades and accomplishments.
My story starts pretty early in Anna's career, and that is when she was a senior in high school. I got to watch her play basketball, which luckily was not as fantastic an experience as watching her learn how to row. But the things that we spotted about Anna right away is that she was the first one down the court. She was beating most of the guards up and down the floor. And then we found out about what kind of a track star she was. And with that kind of engine and height together, we knew that Anna had a ton of potential. So she came in with a lot of gifts. And some of the most important ones that made her a fantastic rower and a fantastic teammate were her foundation in family and the family support and the fact that her parents were at every single event I ever was at, which is all of them. Her brother ran track here, her uncle rode here. It was a family deal. And that just makes, you know, the blood kind of purple. Probably the most important thing Anna brought to a team is not measurable quantitatively. It is a sense of joy and trust and honor that she brings to her team, to her boat.
Her first race was when she was 4 years old. She ran a track race over in Bellevue, and she won the race 400 meters, and her prize was wear a pair of shoes at Nordstrom's. And since then, she thought winning was a good idea, so she's been always enjoyed winning and always managed to go to the next level, whether it was locally or the regional level or the nationals. She always liked the opportunity to compete. She was going to walk on at the UW in track and field, but Erin O'Connell offered her the opportunity or challenged that if you try to walk on at the University of Washington crew team, you may win a national title. 9 months later, she won her first NC2A title.
Anna loved being part of the University of Washington crew team. The friends that she made here are lifelong friends. She loved the atmosphere. She was very disciplined, but she had just amazing experience. So we are indeed very, very lucky and honored to be Anna's parents.
What's special about Anna and why she's so deserving of wearing the purple jacket is because of her character. She is through and through a Husky. She bleeds purple. But no matter how bad practice was, no matter how overloaded you get during life, you always knew going into the starting line that Anna was gonna go full on. I mean, Washington taught us to win. And there was nobody I would rather have than Anna in my eights. And she has become more of a teammate, a dear friend, and I love her dearly. But one of the things I think I'm the most proudest of Anna is that the changes that she chose to better herself from the Athens silver to that commitment into seeing if we can change that silver into gold. And just by witnessing her determination of changing her diet, changing the way that she approached practice, working on her body, I mean, Anna, you couldn't erg for a while, and then now you did all the things you PR'd during that last Olympic year, and I think it may have had to do a little bit with meeting Bob. And I think just seeing you fall in love with Bob and having you guys become a team and having your faith shine through, it was just a privilege watching you grow into that person that got that gold. I love you. You deserve the purple jacket. And I'm so proud of you.
Wow. How cool is that? Let's hear it. Boy, you almost get, didn't you almost get like a chill when you saw that Olympic thing? Oh, it's just fantastic. Bestowing the purple jacket on Anna Mickelson tonight is Eleanor McElvain, acclaimed Washington women's rowing coach and Anna's former coach. Ladies and gentlemen, Anna Mickelson.
Make you cry. My goodness. There's a lot of people here. I want to thank you all for this wonderful award, and I prepared a few words to share my gratitude. Obviously, to share this stage with Pocock is, you know, something that any rower's dream, so it's an honor to be here with you and your family this evening. I, of course, would like to pass my thanks to my coaches, of whom they still support me to this day, Eleanor McIlvain, my novice rowing coach, who would kick all of our butts in the weight room and show us how it was done. That's how we do it on the team, is she would just go for it. She was also the one who personally helped fundraise for my teammate and I to participate in a race in Boston, as well as she submitted all my rowing machine scores to U.S. Rowing, helping open the doors for me to represent our country. Thank you for planting that seed. Jaren Harville, my varsity coach, who couldn't be here tonight, she kept me humble and still thought I needed a seatbelt in the boat as a sophomore. And Aaron O'Connell, our assistant coach, really helped me when I was deciding to row and not run. Sorry, Coach Metcalf. Aaron told me that she thought that I could take this as far as I wanted, and when I asked her what she meant, she looked me straight in the eye and said, as far as you like. And then I got the picture of what she was trying to say. I want to thank everybody in the athletic department, especially those who are keeping the Washington tradition alive. They run this show, from the day-to-day operations to all the healthcare staff, to those who provide scholarships for young men and women like myself. You've given us not only a great place to compete, but to be a student athlete as well. And with receiving some scholarship money, my husband and I have been in turn able to use our college savings to open our business. So Cummins Chiropractic's over in Bellevue if you have the need. To those who ran the Athletes in Action program here and led a Bible study for the crew, Pam and Gary Shavey, I thank them for helping us keep our eyes on the true prize in heaven and how we could use rowing and all of our actions to glorify Jesus. Learning that here at UW truly kept me solid during some of the long, hard training days preparing for the Olympics and as I retired and finished up rowing. There was a huge freedom in rowing for Jesus and not for what other people thought of my efforts, and I can't thank them enough for that spiritual coaching. Well, hopefully now many of you guys have read the book, The Boys in the Boat, and if not, and being here this evening, I hope you'll pick it up. It's at Costco. I'm proud and thankful to have been one of Washington's The Girls in the Boat. Just like that crew of 1936 story, there were no superstars, but a team who respected and pulled for each other. During my 4 years here, like my dad, I've calculated some things. I've had a chance to calculate how many seats there were in the championship eights we were a part of. So there were 36 seats. And of those seats, there were 22 separate varsity boatmates that I had who pulled my tired body down the lake. That's not even counting the rest of the women on the squad who we trained with every day and pulled out the team championships. We had a novice boat, a JV boat, straight four varsity boats, and people who would just erg all practice long and they wouldn't even get boated. So that's at least another 100 teammates alone here rowing for the Huskies. Rowing is truly a team sport, and I would keep you all here until tomorrow if I were here to share how each one of those amazing women helped me to become a better rower in person. And now I've saved the best for last. My family, who is here tonight to celebrate this special night, I have to specifically thank my guests of honor, my grandmother, Patty Mickelson, whom I can still hear you cheering for me in my mind's eye as I race around the track, and my grandfather, Stan Mickelson, UW alum, who played basketball for Heck Ed here 77 years ago. Granddad. Granddad, thank you for believing in me, and you had me sign my first autograph when I signed a Husky ball cap for you. I had my brother's signature on it, too, so thank you for supporting and believing in me. I also thank the UW men's crew team for providing some common ground for me to find a tall, smart, and athletic husband. After we were done rowing, of course, we met. But really, my husband, Bob Cummins, who already has his purple jacket, thank you for your love and support during the Olympics, and more importantly, each and every day after. It's a joy to be your wife and to raise our soon-to-be three children so that they will bleed purple just like us. And finally, my mom and dad, Dave and Denise Mickelson. You probably feel like you are just doing what all moms and dads do by loving and supporting me throughout the years, but you truly are world championship parents. Your sacrificial love and support, yes, when I was 4, but also when I was 28, they gave me the freedom to pursue becoming the best rower that I could be. By cheering at every race, buying needed shoes and uniforms, and feeding me awesome food, and praying for me each and every day, you not only love me, but each of my teammates, your other daughters as well. You are the mom and dad in the boat. Thank you all so very much.
Thank you, Anna. Oh my goodness, is that spectacular? You know, and I love the part about the Husky lineage. My wife is also a Husky. It wasn't on the checklist, but it was helpful, you know. And I don't know, most of you have been to a football game so far this season. Have you seen the video where I'm up there dancing, so to speak? Right. Well, my back still hurts from that. But my daughter Marissa is here. She's one of the dancers on the video and taught me all the steps. And I point this out because, sweetie, you see the legacy, baby. Yeah. All right. Next, receiving the purple jacket is one of the most acclaimed track and field stars in Washington history and a darn good football player as well, Jawarren Hooker.
But he's just a great young man. And, you know, he has a million-dollar smile, and I think that, you know, in speaking to his former teammates that were on, you know, a Pac-10 4x4 championship team with him, you know, Jawarren, you know, instantly made the young men around him better. And I guess when you look at, you know, what are the ingredients to being, you know, being a Hall of Famer at the University of Washington, I would talk about your impact, you know, on your teammates and the people around you. And Jawarren was spectacular. And I'll keep using that word because that's what he was. And, you know, to this very day, you know, he's our school record holder. Got at every event, you know, 55 meters, 60 meters, 100 meters, 200 meters, 400 meters. You know, he was the greatest sprinter that had ever walked onto our campus, for sure.
Well, he was a year-round athlete. I mean, he ran winter track, spring track, spring ball, winter football. He was busy all the time, but it was that energy flow that he had and obviously his speed.
And just like everything else in Jawarren's career, you know, the very first time he ever touches the football as a Husky, you know, in Arizona, I remember watching it on TV because at that point, you know, I'm a track coach at Washington. You watch a potential superstar, and our hope is that he doesn't get hit, stuff like that. But you know, he touches the ball for the first time, you know, and it's like it's a made for TV movie. You know, he gets the ball, he goes 89 yards untouched against Arizona, and you know, chapter number one has been written, you know, in the lore of Jawarren Hooker.
When he stepped up to the 400 meter, it really became his bread and butter race. But you know, throughout it was a work ethic that separated Jawarren from everybody else.
You know, fast forward through his entire career, and you know, Jawarren, you know, just was a spectacular young man. You know, in every facet. I mean, I can remember conversations that you know we had, you know, debating on whether how fast he could run 800 meters on the track, which usually ended in, you know, Jawarren, you probably can't run that fast.
Well, I gotta believe that because he was a two-sport letterman, that he is in a very unique category within this Hall of Fame. I don't imagine there are a lot who were able to excel in both sports like the way he did, but certainly his being a member of the Olympic team was a tremendous accomplishment.
Jawarren, hey, congratulations on your induction in the Hall of Fame. It's a fantastic honor for, you know, for our track and field program and especially for you. It's incredibly well deserved, and you know, I'm incredibly proud of everything that you've done and you know and excited about what your future still holds. But Jawarren, congratulations on this fantastic honor.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, bestowing the purple jacket on Jawarren Hooker tonight is Greg Metcalf, University of Washington head track and field coach, and Jawarren's former coach. Ladies and gentlemen, Jawarren Hooker.
thank you guys for joining us tonight. I didn't know that this was a big deal until I got up here today, so you're going to have to bear with me for a second. You know, anytime you get recognized for something that you did 17 years ago, it's usually because you're dead. So that's kind of another thing that I'm not sure if this is a good thing or bad thing. But when I walked onto this campus 17 years ago, you know, I didn't get recruited. I got recruited because I was a great athlete, but the things that I saw here at the University of Washington was tradition. It was honor, integrity, winning, and excellence. And when I walked onto the school, I knew that my athletic career would only take me so far. And when I left, I wanted to leave with some of those awesome attributes that the University of Washington bestowed upon me. So 4.5 years later, because I was one of those smart athletes to leave on time, you know, I knew that I left with something far more valuable than catching a touchdown pass or winning a race. I left with attributes that I would be able to carry on so far in my life. So as I walk back onto this campus 17 years later, it has been a long time, I know that I'm a better person because of coming to the University of Washington. There was no coincidence that I came here. It was fate, it was destiny. I'm just so honored to be a part of this Hall of Fame team. I'm so honored to bleed purple and gold. One of the biggest things that I got from being here, like I said, were attributes that I could live on a lot longer than catching a football pass or being in front of 75,000 people winning a football game. You know, I wanted to be recognized and remembered as the type of person I was. You know, my mom and dad, they know me as Jawarren, okay? My brothers and sisters, they know me as Wani. You know, my wife knows me as Jawarren, and my daughter knows me as Daddy. And I always wanted to live that sort of a lifestyle and not know me as a football player or a track athlete because I'm far more valuable than that. You know, when I walk down the street, one of the biggest things that, you know, the biggest things that I can get from other people is that you're a Husky. That's something that's stamped on us, whether you know it or not. Once you wear that purple and gold jersey, or once you put that W on your chest, you're a Husky for life. So I know that I was at the right place at the right time. I got a great education here. UW has invested in me way more than I can ever think about repaying them. I knew that when I came onto this campus, like I said, 17 years ago, and when I left, I wanted to be able to give them back what they've given me. So now at this point in time in my life, I feel like I've actually given you back the investment that you bestowed upon myself. So thank you guys. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for always being there supporting me, even though, Mom, you didn't know what the heck I was doing when I was running races. You know that you're getting old when, you know, you talked. I brought my daughter in the Hall of Fame room, and I said to her, like, you know, your daddy used to be pretty fast. And she's like, I'm faster. And I'm like, whatever. But, you know, you know you're really old when, you know, I asked my little sister, I said, you know, your brother used to be pretty good back in the day. And she's like, yeah, in the late 80s. I'm like, that wasn't that long ago. Yeah. So I feel like this is a lifetime achievement award, but I'm still alive. So it's kind of weird. But like I said, thank you guys very much. I hope you guys are enjoying this. Thank you for the opportunity to wear this purple and gold jacket. I'm very honored. Thank you.
Wow. Fantastic. Next, we have our first team of the evening, the 2009 softball team. Yeah, I know you're over there. I tell you what, this team knows what perseverance is all about. Let's take a look back at their journey to the top, the 2009 softball team.
A few things stand out a lot to me about this 2009 team. First of all, we were really experienced. We finished third at the College World Series in 2007, and we learned a lot by not achieving what we wanted, and that was obviously to get to the championship series and win it all. We also had a lot of learning lessons from the 2008 season when we redshirted Danielle Laurie for the Olympics, and Ashley Charters and Lauren Greer went down with injury, and we basically played that whole season with a lot of youth. So in combination with the lessons learned in 2007 and all of the things that we learned together in 2008, it definitely built us up to that national championship season in 2009.
having Heather Tarr run the softball program at the University of Washington, knowing that she was here as a student athlete and cares so much about this program and developing it and building it on the legacy that she was a part of from the very beginning of softball being created at the University of Washington, makes it extra special. She understood the value of hard work. She appreciated the people whose shoulders she was standing on to have the opportunity to be a head coach, to build a program, to lead us to a national championship, which she firmly believes the program was added with the expectation that it would win a championship during its tenure, and she was the coach that was able to do it, which is really special.
The 2019 was a very great mix of people. We had some stars, we had some big time role players, we had a great mix of talent and depth. And I think the thing that made our team so strong is that everybody wanted to play any role that was given to them. So whether it was on the bench and coming up with the coolest cheers ever to try to get us the momentum to get across the wins, onto Danielle Laurie being able to pitch so many games for us that year and just really putting the whole team on her back, to Ashley Charters being able to keep Danielle's mindset on the right things, to then adding Jen Salling to our infield that was already strong, move Morgan Stewart to third base, and having some of the freshmen come through like Kimmy Pullman and Nikki Williams. It was just such a great mixture. We had seven seniors that year. That definitely helped our leadership, and it was just a very, very well-rounded team.
So being at UMass, that was not a televised regional, and they were excited to have the opportunity to host at the time, and they had brought in their own lights and wanted to play at night, and it set up for a challenging regional, and obviously we went through the regional, but what I remember is the Sunday where we were playing to go for a berth to the Super Regionals, and we played our first seven-inning game and lost, and had to turn around and play a game right after that, and that's the game that was exceptional, and that was the 15-inning game that ended at 2 in the morning. But what people don't realize is that was actually 22 innings in that day with Danielle pitching all 22 innings. And I would have to say, this more so than anything, the 15-game inning that was played was, in my career, one of the best sporting events, watching two elite athletes absolutely get after it and go toe-to-toe to see who could win the game. And watching Danielle go against the UMass pitcher was nothing short of spectacular. It's not very often that you get the opportunity to congratulate a team on a national championship, the first national championship in that particular sport, but to say thank you to them for being such incredible role models and such outstanding representatives of the University of Washington, but then to be able to congratulate them on getting inducted into the University of Washington Hall of Fame is pretty special. So congratulations to that very, very
yeah!
special team.
All right. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. The 2009 student athletes, Alicia Blake, Ashley Charters, Jenna Clifton, Amanda Fleischman, Lauren Greer, Drew Hester, Marnie Kozel, Danielle Laurie, Allison McWhirter, Kimberly Pullman, Jennifer Salling, Taylor Smith, Bailey Stimson, Danielle Stewart, Morgan Stewart, Ashley Tuiasosopo, Jessica Ventosa, Allison Watson, Nikki Williams. And joining the 2009 softball players, the coaching staff, head coach Heather Tarr, Gina Carbonato, JT D'Amico, Lance Glasso, here they are! Yeah. Speaking on behalf of the 2000 softball team is outfielder Allison McWhirter.
Wow, there is a lot of people here. Never in our wildest childhood dreams could we have conceived of this very special moment in our lives. It is my profound honor to speak on behalf of these exceptional women. First, we'd like to congratulate our fellow Huskies with whom we share this evening. To be in their company is our sincere privilege. Second, we would not be standing here on this stage if not for the many contributions of others. To our alma mater, thank you for sharing your legacy. To our coaches, thank you for your guidance and faith in this team. And to all our supporters, our mothers, fathers, brothers and sisters, family and friends, who bore the true weight of our struggles as emerging athletes, we are eternally grateful. Without your constant and unwavering support, we wouldn't have become who we were destined to be. We may spend the rest of our lives thriving because of the incredible foundation you all helped us to build. And the words thank you would never be enough. But in an effort to articulate the true passion in each of us, we thank you from the bottom of our hearts. It is said that life's greatest moments are the ones you share, and we are so grateful, humbled, and honored to share this moment with those that mean the most to us. I could spend the next few minutes listing several descriptive and meaningful words about this team, words that describe each person, words like strength, skill, character, dedication, discipline, and words like hope, confidence, aspiration, passion, and courage. But I'm afraid that these words won't adequately convey the true essence of this team. We started as dreamers with a vision of conquering the unconquerable, but what we became was something so much more than that. Our journey started like every year always does, countless hours of practicing and conditioning, meeting new teammates and filling the holes of the recently graduated. We practiced every day, conditioned like everyone else, went through endless fielding drills and the ever-present and time-consuming batting practices. We did the same thing as every other softball team in the nation. So what was different about this 2009 team? We all had strong and unique personalities, layers upon layers of it. Idealists, entrepreneurs, dreamers, visionaries, and ultimately champions. Nobody on this team was ever comfortable settling for the status quo. It wasn't in our nature to settle. We were born this way, but that wasn't what made us different. The answer revealed itself in who we became that year. Upon the foundation of individual effort and the burning desire from each individual to deliver maximum performance beyond the limits of their individual capabilities, the team formed into the most powerful entity I have ever had the privilege of being a part of. Call it the X factor, if you like. Everyone talked about it, but nobody really knew what it was, how to define it, or how to use it to our advantage. Years later, even in hindsight, there is still such a sense of awe associated with this team. We spent the entire season making the most of each opportunity and trying to prove to ourselves, to each other, and to the world that we deserved a place on that field. Playing time and roles seemed to vary every weekend as we searched for the winning combination. The truth is, we were unknowingly building it all along. We could feel the transformation slowly taking shape as we went from a team of individuals competing selfishly to a team full of selfless individuals. Ultimately, we wanted to compete for each other instead of against each other. And by the time we played in that epic 15-inning season-defining game at the University of Massachusetts, we had figured it out. Our roles were defined. We knew we couldn't win unless every single one of us showed up to play. And when the voice in the dugout became as instrumental as the pitch itself, we had moved beyond the promise of what made that year different and crashed headfirst in the team we were destined to become. We came from different backgrounds and experiences, and in truth lacked a lot of commonalities, all but one. When these believers, success seekers, and individuals channeled their specific passions into one shared goal, to play for each other, a championship team was born. We were unbeatable. We were the X factor. We were the champions before we ever won the title. And as a favorite author once wrote, who we are is why we win. You may recall Derek Brooks saying that most people will forget what you say, some people will forget what you do, but no one will ever forget how you made them feel. And we will never forget how the Husky Nation made us feel on a muggy June night in Oklahoma City 5 years ago. Look at these amazing women. I'm forever grateful to each Husky behind me and this incredible university, because I'll never forget that feeling. Our season ended in that one beautiful moment, forever etched in our memories, and your recognition of our team this evening makes it timeless. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2009 softball team. Baby up here too. It's been an interesting night. All right, let's shift inside to this very arena to honor one of Washington's most dedicated and decorated volleyball players, Christal Morrison. Yeah, Christal. It's your turn now, girl. All right, let's take some time to review her many accolades. Christal Morrison.
Christal and I actually didn't like each other because we were rivals in high school and in club volleyball. And the reason I didn't like her is because she was so good and she beat us all the time. And she's just such a dynamic player. She looks natural when she's playing the game, and she's a fierce competitor. You can see her fire. She was always working so hard for the person next to her. And as a setter, we had a pretty special relationship, being best friends off the court. And she just fights for you and fights for the team every single point. And She's such a hard worker, and she has this ability to make plays when the team needs her to. And as a hitter, she just took huge swings. And any time it was close in a game, she'd just look at me, you know, as a setter, and kind of give me that face. And we didn't even need to talk about it. No words needed to be said, but I knew she wanted the ball, and she took care of it. And she's just the ultimate competitor, and also has just genuine love for the game. And there's so much joy and excitement, and it makes it really fun to play with someone that competes that hard, but also enjoys every second of it.
The first time I got to see her play, it was easy to see she had great athletic ability. She was fast, she jumped high, she could hit hard. But then I got to watch her and looked even closer at how she behaved and how she looked at the coaches in timeouts, how she treated her teammates. And I liked her more the more I watched her. Clearly she had the athletic ability, but what separates people are these other areas, how she commits to things, how she works, her work ethic. And I was more interested in seeing those things. I remember a number of coaches had come to me and said, "Hey Jim, I don't know if she's tough enough." And I often wonder what their definition of toughness is. To me, it's, you know, doing the right things, making the right choices, committing at the highest level, hitting your serve when your best serve is needed, being in the right place at the right time, having the ability to stay focused on the things that tell you what to do. And Christal Morrison became one of the best players I've ever coached in those areas, and that's really what separated her. But I remember one thing that was unique to Christal. We had just won the Elite Eight. We were going to the Final Four, and my daughter Molly came over after the match and said, "Dad, why is Christal crying?" And so I thought it was her knee. There was a point in the season where she had hurt her knee and tore her meniscus. And so I thought the season was over. Here's a team that's ranked number one. We lose our best player, and I'm thinking, uh-oh. And so we met with the doctors, and the doctors, Christal had come to me and said, "Jim, I'm playing." And I said, no, there's more important things in life. Someday you're gonna carry little babies, you're gonna do things that are more important than volleyball, and you need a good knee. We met with the doctors, her parents were there, and the doctors had told me she can play. We will not further the injury because of the nature of the tear. And so she was able to play. Well, that night in the Elite Eight, after we won, we're going to the Final Four, Chris is crying. Molly tells me, I walked around the corner and she dried up her tears and I said, your knee's hurting. And she says, no, it's my foot. And she had, because of the pain in her knee, had landed on her foot the wrong way and developed a stress fracture. And no one knows this, and people don't understand that she went through all this and still played in the Final Four. The doctors told me she had 25 jumps in her. And we tried to win that match in the Final Four with Krista playing 25 plays. But to me, that's the sign of courage and toughness. And I think down deep, that's what Huskies are all about. Krista, when I think of the Husky Hall of Fame, there's so many great people in it. You're so deserving in so many ways. But when I think of Steve Edmund and Don James, Lawyer Malloy, Napoleon Kaufman, all these great dogs, I believe in my heart you fit in. And it's an honor. It's an honor of the highest degree. It's the University of Washington. And it's going to be neat to see you in the Hall of Fame. Congratulations.
Ladies and gentlemen, bestowing the purple jacket on Christal Morrison tonight is Jim McLaughlin, current University of Washington head volleyball coach and the coach to Christal Morrison. Ladies and gentlemen, Christal Morrison.
I'm gonna cry again tonight, Jim. I'm not injured, but I'm very emotional. Oh, Mike, sorry. I'm taller than most people. Wow, I can't really believe that I'm standing here right now. I'm gonna button my jacket just to make it official. Buttoning it makes it official. All right, first off, I just wanna thank the University of Washington. I'm so proud to be a Husky, and I'm so proud to be a part of this university. I also wanna thank the Big W Club for putting this event on and the sponsors for donating, thank you. It's a really awesome night. I wanna thank the committee who voted for the inductees this year. This is an incredible class to be among, and I'm absolutely humbled to be included in the University of Washington Hall of Fame. My years playing volleyball at Washington are so special to me. It's gonna be okay, trust me. I would not be here right now if it wasn't for my teammates and coaches. Dang it. Oh. I was surrounded by some of the most elite athletes and world-class coaching staff. And each and every one of their skills pushed me to be better every day. But it wasn't just who they were as athletes and coaches, it was who they were as people that really touched me and made me who I am today. My best friend Courtney, and fearless leader, Courtney Thompson, set the bar for me with her determination and work ethics. She was and is, to this day, the greatest leader and friend an outside hitter could ask for. She also may have helped me move up the leaderboard in career stats and games against Arizona, UCLA, Penn State, where I'm pretty sure she just threw every ball my way. So thanks, Court, and Steve and Linda for, you know, having her. Okay. Jim McLaughlin was a father figure to me for my entire career. He was the best mentor, teacher, and leader I could have asked for. Every athlete dreams for a coach who believes in them more than they believe in themselves. It still moves me today to think back and realize how much Jim believed in me, how much he guided me, and how much he wanted me to succeed. Jim,
You are truly special to me, and I can't thank you enough for believing in me and helping me reach my goals. Okay, get your tissues ready, because this is the real part here now. To my family, playing 4 years of volleyball, shoot. Playing 4 years of volleyball for the University of Washington was the most amazing gift I could have received and given to my family. Every step along the way, I had the most incredible support from my family. The sacrifices they made to be a part of the journey are insurmountable. From a simple preseason game to Pac-10 play at the time, to playoffs and ultimately a national championship run, they were all there every step of the way. My time at Washington was more valuable than I could have ever imagined. Its value is held in the memories that I made with my family. Dan, Kathy, Jean, Nora, Mike, Michelle, Kelly, Brian, Heather, and April, thank you for being here tonight to share this with me. You all mean the world to me, and I'm incredibly blessed to have family like you. To my brothers, I love you guys so much. Thanks for beating me up when I was little. You made me tough. It's true. To my grandparents, Grandma Sylvia, Grandpa Arlen, Crazy Grandma. It's okay, it's self-proclaimed. She will introduce herself that way. She's Crazy Grandma. Grandma Sylvia, you are a bright light that has always shown me how to shine. Thank you for that. I love you. Arlen and Charlotte, thank you for being you. The memories we have made after a second chance given will always be closest to my heart. I love you. To my amazing husband, I love you more than anything. You are my best friend and the love of my life. And I know that my time at Washington was before you, but you are here now and you're more a part of this as everyone else is. To my mom and dad, thank you for your unconditional love and support. I will never be able to repay you for the sacrifices you have made to help me get here. But I hope that one day I can pay it forward to my own kids. You have taught me how to be an incredible parent. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm so incredibly humbled to receive this award and eternally grateful that I get to share this night with everyone who means the most to me.
Oh my goodness. Have to just kind of take a deep breath after that one, huh? Oh my goodness. To his contemporaries, our next inductee was commonly referred to as the greatest athlete they ever saw in a Husky uniform. This is none other than Dave Williams.
So many things come to mind, but I think his incredible character, first of all, and it's a result of these habits that were ingrained from the time he first started playing with his brothers, this rough and tumble crew out of Tacoma, and then that turned into organized sports and Lincoln High School, at Galt Junior High and Lincoln High School, and later at the University of Washington. It was this combination of toughness, of habits, and this joy for the game.
To put some of his records in perspective, in 1965, when Dave Williams set the record, which still stands, for 257 yards receiving in one game, it was a time when not very many passes were thrown. In fact, That year under Coach Jim Owens, the Huskies threw 19 passes a game, and you can compare that to the Six Killer era where they and the Cody Pickett era where receivers had 50 chances a game or more. So that was remarkable, and in that season, he caught 38% of all of the Husky passes thrown during that year. For pundits of track and field, Dave Williams' performance in the 1965 dual meet with Oregon probably will last forever as a piece of Husky lore. He participated in 6 events in the dual meet in Eugene, and he won 4 events and led the Huskies to a rare victory over one of the best dual meet teams in the country. At that time, dual meet track was very, very popular, and it was a big part of all of the track and field programs. So this really carried a lot of weight at that time.
It takes an enormous amount of natural talent, and he had both. And it was not only in the sports that he was best known for, football and track, but he was also a heck of a basketball player and just fantastic at anything he attempted. And he when he was a sophomore in college, he was at the Olympic trials in the decathlon. And as soon as the football season ended, he would head up to the indoor season for track and field, and he would miss spring ball, but he'd be back at it at football in the summer, and then on his way to becoming an All-American. So it took an incredible amount of resiliency, a ton of character, and a ton of flexibility, and that's all great in a sports context. But he was also able to apply that adaptability and that resiliency later on to a variety of careers and to carry his athletic success into private life, which not everybody is always able to do. And I'm immensely proud of him for that. Dad, I just want you to know how proud of you we all are, and what a great role model you've been to us, and that we're tickled and thrilled that you're inducted into the Husky Hall of Fame with so many great players, but taking your rightful place alongside them as well. And we just want to say congratulations, and we love you.
Ladies and gentlemen, bestowing the purple jacket on Dave Williams tonight is Jeff Williams, Dave's son.
Boy, this feels good. Where's Jer Warren? Where's he? Let me tell you, 17 years is nothing, man. Try 47. All right? You know what? I'll keep this as short as I can. It's a long evening, and it's already past my bedtime, so I'm going to move through this as quick as I can. The purple jacket. I'm very honored and humbled to be here tonight and inducted into the University of Washington Hall of Fame. It's a dream come true for me to be with such amazing people as we all don the purple jacket. I'm especially happy to be included into the hall the same year with the late Dr. Joe Kearney. I knew Joe from his days at Tumwater High and my days at Lincoln at Tacoma. He was my receiver coach during training camp my senior year with the Huskies, and was a fine man. I would like to thank the Big W Club, the alumni, the selection committee, the Husky Athletic Department, and mostly to the University of Washington, which in my humble opinion is the finest overall university in America. The purple jacket's not about me. It's about the University of Washington. In the spring of my senior year of high school, and after careful consideration for many other fine offers, I accepted a Scholastic Athletic Scholarship from the University of Washington to play football and run track and field. I chose the Huskies for 2 reasons. First, it was the very best education a young person could ever wish for. And second, I chose it because I knew the experience would be hard. To succeed in life, I knew I would need to be challenged mentally and physically. I needed to be trained, tested, measured, and tempered. Guys, if I wanted easy, I would have gone to that school in Eugene, right? Or one of those two schools in LA. It's not about me. None of the inductees here tonight none of the inductees would be here tonight without the care, love, and support from many others during their lives. For me, it's about Jesus, and it's about Sherry. One has my soul, and the other has my heart. Okay, that's a good thing, because all of the inductees here can tell you tonight, when you dedicate your bodies to sport, it's going to take a beating. There may be pieces of you left all over athletic venues. That's the reason I walk weird. So with a beat up body, you better have your heart and soul in the right place. Now, if you think I walk weird, wait till I get to be as old as Mario and Jaworan. This is not about me. It's about my parents, Joe and Cleo Williams, both of whom passed away several years ago, but are looking down from heaven with huge smiles on their faces. It's about my family, wife Sherry, who was the best catch I ever made. It's about my sons and daughters, grandchildren, brothers, sisters, and all the Williams family. I give a huge thanks to our oldest son, Jeff, who doggedly pursued my induction. A special thanks to my sister, Susan. She's a real Husky in our family. She worked on the Husky campus for 47 years and wrote letters on my behalf to be inducted into the hall for the last 27 years. Her persistence finally paid off. What a great sister. Now, it does beg the question, what was she doing for the first 20 years? Maybe waiting for tenure, I don't know. It's not about me. It's about all my coaches, Jim Owens, Don Makita, Bob Sorrett, Tom Tipps, Stan Heiserman. It's about all my teammates, guys like Donnie Moore, Jimmy Lambright, Rick Redmond, Ron Medved, Fred Forsberg, Todd Holland, Billy Parker, Jim Cope, Bill Rowe, Dave Dupree, Phil Schenick, who is absolutely the best athlete I've ever seen, John Sims, I could go on and on. It's about my old friend Brian Sternberg. One needs to go no further than Brian to gather all the inspiration needed for life. It's not about me. It's about the fans, the sports writers, the media, and all the support we see from everyone here in the great Northwest. So you see, I'm just a vehicle used tonight for this induction ceremony, because a real purple jacket goes to all those who supported me over the years. If you look closely at my purple jacket, you will see a patchwork quilt with 1,000 names of those who brought me here tonight. They are woven into the very fabric of my being, and I'm eternally grateful to all of them. Finally, for the old timers here, Jim and Don especially, Coach Owen has a system when we play to practice jerseys. First team wore purple, second team wore gold, third team wore red, and fourth team wore green. The third and fourth teams were the meat squads. We ran the other team's plays and had the crap beat out of us at every practice. Our practice sessions were tougher than the games. We all played hard and hoped we'd move up to the first or second team. All of us players had nicknames for the squads: the Perps, the Goldies, the Red Raiders, and the Green Weenies. Trust me, for I played on all four squads in my tenure with Coach Owens, and it was tough. I was the unofficial captain of the Green Weenies. So tonight, my purple jacket is especially for all the unsung heroes, the Red Raiders, and the Green Weenies. Thanks, and God bless all of you.
Oh, that's just great. Fantastic. Thank you so much, Dave. All right, next, our second team award tonight, inducted into the Husky Hall of Fame, is the 2008 Women's Cross Country Team. Yes, there you are. As the most dominant cross country team in Washington history, let's look back at their memorable year, rising to the occasion and winning the national championship, the 2008 Women's Cross Country Team.
Thank you.
in 2008, you know, and I've talked about it lots after the fact, but, you know, I've never experienced a period of time, you know, like we did that fall when nothing went wrong. Nobody got sick, nobody got hurt. It was nothing but, you know, months of absolute perfection. And, you know, I used the word at the time, you know, that our group had incredible, you know, team chemistry, but more importantly, we had incredible team synergy. And it was an incredible collection of young women that were wholly and solely focused on doing the same thing and accomplishing something that here had never been accomplished before.
The day of the Pac-10 championships, when I got off a plane on a football road trip, and the athletic director who was with us asked how they'd done, so I looked into it, made a call to the guy with the cross-country team and was told that we recorded a perfect score, which I'd never really heard of in the sport. Obviously, it's feasible, but it just seems so unlikely that it could never happen. And that's a level of dominance I don't think I'd ever heard of in a sport like that.
We had, I mean, six women run, you know, under 16:25 for 5K cross-country, which is unheard of. No one does that. But this group did. And so we went into the Auburn Invite, you know, wherever we were ranked, and we came out, and that weekend we were the number one ranked team in the country.
You know, Oregon, frankly, has a tradition of being the track school of, if not the country, at least the West Coast, and rightfully so. They've certainly established that reputation. But in a sport where they are usually the dominant team, to go to their place in a meet where they're definitely going to run their best runners in a championship event and to dominate it so thoroughly is just something that even the most positive-minded Husky fan couldn't possibly have guessed.
So the next morning, I had coffee with a friend of mine who coaches at Oregon State University. He said, "Coach," he goes, "Greg, how you guys doing?" And I go, "We're ready." And I said, "Kelly, I think that we can score 15 points today." And he thought at that point that I was crazy for saying this. And you know, and to this day, I've never seen anything more incredibly cool than what happened on the Springfield golf course that day. The gun went off. And, you know, Kendra Schaaf goes right to the lead. And I think every single step she took, her lead got bigger. And she won in absolutely dominant fashion. And so as a freshman, it was an awesome effort. And then what happened behind her was an Oregon women's team battling our women's team, which another freshman, Christine Babcock at the time, was running with Oregon's top three women. And just, she destroyed them, for lack of a better term. And then you could see Christine and Mel and, you know, Anita kind of rolling up behind them. And you could see it happening. And then just past the halfway point, you could see, you know, the Oregon women started to fade. I think at one point, you know, Mel and Katie Fault were running by a group of Oregon fans, and they were yelling, and they said something about it. They were getting tired. And I think Mel turned to Katie and said, "I'm not tired." And, you know, at this point, the greatest sound you'll ever hear in Eugene, Oregon was the hush of the Oregon fans as they watched this happen. It was absolutely incredible. And perfection is something that we talk about, but for the most part, it is unattainable. And on one day, at one moment in time, we had six women put out massive effort to go take down the number two team in the country and go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
In my time here at the University of Washington, there have been a few teams that have performed so well and so consistently over the course of the season. And if there's anybody better than the 2008 Husky Women's Cross Country team, I'm not sure what it would be. So congratulations to all of you on your induction tonight.
Yeah, how about that? You gotta love it. Making people from Oregon be quiet. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, give a warm welcome to the 2008 Women's Cross Country Team. Brooke Anderson, Christine Babcock, Anita Campbell, Kelly Campbell, Katie Follett, Maureen Huber, Marie Lawrence, Amanda Miller, Kenna Patrick, Lauren Saylor, Kendra Schaaf, and joining the 2008 Women's Cross Country Student Athletes is 2008 Head Coach Gref Metcalf. Representing the 2008 women's team tonight is Anita Campbell.
My heart's still pounding after watching that video. So, first off, thank you so much to the Big W Club, John Otness, Karen Young, everyone who helped put this together. This is really an incredible event, and we're so proud and honored to be a part of it, amongst so many other Husky greats. It's still a very surreal feeling for me, and I think for everyone else, to just say that we are the 2008 national champions. There's so much work that goes into it, and you know, to this day, I can still remember in 2007, sitting in a big white tent in Terre Haute, Indiana, and we had just gotten eighth place, and I think it was the best finish by our women's program ever, and we weren't satisfied, and we probably should have been ecstatic. We had two All-Americans that year, and we just felt like we missed an opportunity, and so we went back home and just knew that there was more to do, and we had a whole year to get it together. So fast forwarding to 2008, and we added two superstar freshmen who we wouldn't have been able to do this without, and they were completely unfazed by anyone or anything and got the job done every single day. And for the first time in school history, we were, you know, the first ranked team in the country going into the Pac-10 meet, and we were going up against the second ranked team in the country, and we had a huge opportunity in front of us. And you know, it was kind of a sisterhood of purple at that point when we just ultimately dismembered the Oregon Ducks one girl at a time as we took them down. we went 1-6, and Lauren Saylor got 12th place that day, which actually goes unrecognized sometimes, but that's pretty amazing as well. And you know, I hate to say it, but it felt like a workout for us. And we knew that we were in a good place going into nationals. The regional championships that year was another great memory for me, just because I remember, you know, we rested a couple girls, and we had a couple girls that were able to step up and get the job done. And you know, it was a testament to, you know, they were able to contribute to the greatness that was 2008 for us, and you know, everyone was wholeheartedly into it and on the same page and knew what we were gonna make happen. And so that was very special. There's still a lot of, you know, memories that stick out. The Friday before we were heading to the national meet, and we were getting on the bus outside the Graves Annex building, and what felt like the entire athletic department was dressed in purple with signs, and you know, we had Scott Woodward running in his running shoes beside the bus as we pulled out, and it was really just a testament to how we felt supported that year by this entire athletic department, and it was made it that much more special for us. You know, there's a lot of funny moments, but one thing that sticks out for me that I just have to bring up is Coach Metcalf in his superstitious attire that year. He wore the same clothing every single race that we had that year. It was a polo shirt, khaki shorts, and the same hat. And that was all fine when we're on the West Coast, but suddenly we're in Terre Haute, Indiana in 30-degree weather, and he's running alongside you, and you know he's 10 times colder than you are, so you just gotta get it done. thank yous go out to, I mean, a lot of people, but in particular, John Morris, our trainers, the medical staff, Gary McGuire, Mike Bruskus, our families, and the entire athletic department. Special shout out to Kristen Metcalf for sharing your husband's time with us all the time. It's a full-time job, and we take up a lot of it. Thank you to Kelly Strong, who was a big contributor to this program since the beginning, and all of our careers here. She helped recruit us, and she helped us make this dream into a big reality. And finally, Coach Metcalf. It's almost hard to put into words how completely appreciative we are of everything you've done and continue to do for us. You are the University of Washington. I'm sure that even while you were here running as a Husky, you know, you had dreams of standing on the podium with your teammates. And so this by no means was a one-year process. And I know it was a lifetime of long coffee sessions and post-race plane diary writing and countless broken watches. So we can't thank you enough. Your vision for this program and your constant expectation for greatness is very infectious. You've always been 100% committed and passionate about doing everything possible to make this program great. In return, you expected nothing less from us, and we eventually understood that. You deserve that national championship times 10. So thank you for everything, and we love you.
Thank you very much, Anita. The 2008 women's cross country team. Next, we are honoring a Husky administrator with an extraordinary vision and leadership, Joe Kearney. Let's hear more about Joe and his many accomplishments, the late Joe Kearney.
I think in looking at Dr. Joe Kearney in terms of what made him to be so successful is kind of difficult for me. But I can also tell you that it was also a time when he was a very personable person, a very one-on-one person. He had both great interpersonal skills as a great large group skills, and he was able to talk to people in a way, I think, that made them feel comfortable and to make them to be friendly, and he was not confrontational. Now, that does not to mean that he couldn't be firm, and I can tell you, as being my freshman football coach, he could be very firm, but he had a way of getting along with people, and he saw the big picture, and he pushed that forward. He had great vision for the university, and I think that his picks for the coaches that he had and the way that he coached, the way that he administered, the way that he handled people, I think really bodes well for the university and for him.
We all know that he was responsible for recruiting the great Don James and Marv Harshman, and of course they went on to Hall of Fame careers at the university. Joe also hired many other great coaches, and during his tenure, the Huskies were in the top 10 in performance in all of the sports.
We stayed in touch with Joe and Dory for all the time that they were still with us. We love them, we love their family. They're a wonderful family. And all I can say is, thank you, Joe, for bringing us out here, because we love the Northwest, we love the people here. And without Joe Kearney, we would never have been here, and there would never have been a Don James era.
Throughout my long tenure at the University of Washington, I've had the opportunity to work with four directors of athletics, and I know what kind of skill and commitment it takes to do that job. It's very complex. And I know that Joe Kearney, by reputation, had every one of those qualities. I also had an opportunity to work with many of the coaches that Joe hired. Those coaches spoke unilaterally about Joe's great commitment, about his personal connection. He apparently had a great spirit, and it showed through every single day, and the coaches felt like he was there side by side with them through all their efforts.
I want to welcome Joe Kearney into the Husky Hall of Fame. I'm so glad you made it, and I know how much it means to my husband, Dom.
Ladies and gentlemen, giving the purple jacket to the Kearney family tonight is Carol James, wife of legendary coach Don James. Accepting this jacket on behalf of Joe Kearney is his son, Robin.
Well, I don't know if it's stage fright or that great cross-country team, but I feel like running. I'd like to take just a moment to tell you what it means to the Kearney family to have the honor of accepting this award from my father. We're thrilled. We We couldn't be prouder of our father, and I'm humbled to stand in his place and alongside these other great Huskies being inducted. For the Kearney family, I want to try and tell you what this award means to my dad in his own words. A few years ago, I had the duty of sifting through his effects after his passing. He kept nearly every article, speech written, award acceptance speech, letter written, received in an archive. It took me many hours and numerous days to go through that archive, but it reminded me he was a very consistent man with his speech. You could feel his presence and his words, kind, encouraging, and humble. I've taken excerpts from his archive and cobbled together words and phrases that he used often to prepare a speech I imagine he would give to you here tonight. I hope these words are recognizable to people that know him. To be asked by one's university to join an elite roster of coaches, administrators, and athletes I have long admired and respected is both a proud and happy day. It also serves as a reminder how blessed I have been with great staff and coaches I've had the rare privilege of working with, and in many ways, they share in this high honor. By 1973, this exceptional athletic staff at Washington had vaulted Husky athletics to one of the top five Division I universities across all sports. Whatever success I had is due in large part to the people I have had the distinct pleasure to work with. Those 12 years with Washington cemented my love of athletics and higher education. In 1976, I left the University of Washington. I would have loved to have stayed a Husky for my entire career to be a part of what was surely to come. But the program was running smooth and in good hands. Other challenges awaited. The people I left behind to guide Washington were not only capable professionals, they were good people. After 12 years at Washington, there was 4 years at Michigan State, followed by 14 years as commissioner of the Western Athletic Conference. Those I left behind pressed Husky athletics to new heights. I was so happy for their continued success at Washington, and they in turn were happy for my successes. Our relationship over the years was both positive and constructive. And those 12 years at Washington set the stage and allowed me to transfer my experience to these other posts. At this time, I'd like to take a moment to recognize just a few of the many people who made for a successful tenure at the University of Washington. Head basketball coach Tippy Dye, who was my mentor in the early years. Football coach and athletic director Jim Owens, who supported me for the athletic director's chair. Executive assistant Betty Condon, who was the best right hand any athletic director could hope for. The Husky athletic administrative staff, who kept things running smooth, and the athletes, who brought pride and distinction to Husky programs. To the Husky coaches, Dennis Erickson, Ken Shannon, Earl Ellis, Adeen Elensfeldt, Mary DeLay, to name a few, thank you for your consummate professionalism, dedication to your sports, and love of athletics. To the Harshman family, Marv and Dorothy, and to the James family, Don and Carol, my sincerest appreciation for your work, support, and friendship over all these years. For all those mentioned and not, I could not have asked for better people to associate myself with. Thank you to the Hall of Fame Selection Committee for this honor alongside this distinguished and accomplished list of Huskies. And finally, none of this would have been possible without the endless support and love of my dear wife, Dory. She was indeed the wind beneath my wings all these years. Thank you.
Wow. And now, my friends, the last inductee for the evening. A player who etched himself into Husky history with an epic Heisman pose. Our Huskies were victorious in the Rose Bowl and on their way to becoming national champions. And this man was right at the front. Ladies and gentlemen, Mario Bailey.
Well, as a child, the very first time Mario told me he wanted to play
football. And as a single parent, you know, my funds are limited, but he was insistent he wanted to play because he'd been playing around the neighborhood. So I went out and bought cleats for him. And then he went to CAYA and looked at the kids on the field, and they were all much bigger. And he came home and said, I don't want to play. And I said, I'm sorry, you have to play. You had me go buy the cleats. Now you've played in the cleats. The cleats are dirty. I cannot take them back. You are going to play. He was a mama's boy, and he will be the first to tell you, doesn't bother him at all. But he was homesick. He wanted to go home, and Coach James would not let him.
The first time I saw Mario Bailey, I was the coach at the University of Idaho. I was recruiting three of Mario's teammates, and I went to watch Franklin play a high school basketball game. Mario jumped out at me. He could do everything. He could score, he could dribble, he could pass. He set up his teammates. He was unselfish. He guarded, he rebounded, and for a guy that wasn't real big, he played up around the rim. He was sensational. And I remember saying to the coach that I was with, man, would I love to have a guy like that in my offense. Well, sometimes wishes come true, because 11 months later I was here and Mario was in that offense.
I originally got to know Mario Bailey actually as a rival. We both grew up in Seattle, going to Seattle Public High Schools. He went to Franklin, I went to Ingram, and he's always quick to remind me that my senior year, the one and only time Franklin beat us, you know, he had made some good plays in that game, and they were able to win the league championship. But as I said, I got to know him as a rival first, and then as a teammate at the University of Washington, and now I'm honored to call Mario Bailey a friend. Mario Bailey came at a time when Husky football was going through a change, and we had hired a new offensive guru named Keith Gilbertson to come and change the program, where we were just strictly a power running team, and he opened the offense up, and we needed to have a player like Mario Bailey in order to make that change. You know, a wide receiver who was crafty, who got open all the time, who could make all the tough catches, and who was always willing to go across the middle, even though he was of diminutive size. Mario was probably 169 pounds soaking wet, but I saw this guy make some of the best catches and take a lot of punishment and always hang on to the football.
He was a great teammate. He was unselfish. And when we needed a big play to get us going, we called Mario's number.
This has been a long journey. It's been a hard-fought journey. And I am just so proud of the person that he is, that he has become, all the struggles that he's had to go through, and where he is now in his life. I am proud of you. I love you for life. You make me one of the happiest parents in this world, and I only wish the best for you from here on out. Congratulations on a wonderful achievement. You deserve it.
Ladies and gentlemen, bestowing the purple jacket to Mario Bailey tonight is Keith Gilbertson, the offensive coordinator of the 1991 National Championship team, and Mario Bailey's former coach, Gilby.
I'm gonna button it up, Crystal. First, I just thank God. I just this humbling experience. sometimes you don't even feel like you deserve these blessings, but I'll take it. When I was first told I was being inducted in the Hall of Fame, a lot of people said, "Wow, you're not in the Hall of Fame already? You should have been in." And I humbly agreed with them. But at the same time, I told them that, you know, God makes no mistakes. The timing is perfect. It's a perfect time in my life. Had it been 10 years ago, maybe even 2 years ago, I might not appreciate it as much as I do in this moment. I just want to send some thank yous out. Steve and John, please don't turn on the music and don't come up here. First thank you is my Uncle Vic. He couldn't show up tonight. He was sick. But he bought me that first Nerf football, and it just happened to be purple. And you always said I had good hands. And also my brother, Vic, he played football. And I played outside, but putting on those pads is something different. But he convinced me that I could go out there. My first touchdown, he was actually in the end zone with me. He chased me down the field, and I looked over, and there he was. I won't hold it against him. He is a cougar, but that's not as bad as being a duck now, so it's all right. My high school coaches, I have my high school football and basketball coaches here. Along the way, you have coaches that just kind of take extra special care of you. You know, my mom was struggling. Even one of my little league coaches is here, Floyd Richardson. And they made those extra payments. They made sure that you got, they took care of you. My high school coaches both took great care of me. I went in there as a basketball player. Football was always secondary, but I left a football player. By the way, the only time Franklin won Metro in both football and basketball was 1988. Still being humble in here. At the University of Washington, Coach Dick Beard was the first person that contacted me. It's the funniest thing. He's one of the best recruiters in the world. Slick talking, but sincere. Just you didn't know to believe him, but he was so sincere, and I just have to thank you, Coach Beard. Also, the other recruiter was Coach Lambright, who's the defensive coordinator and recruiting an offensive guy. The one thing I can say about Coach is, in your experience in college, you go through ups and downs, but he never turned his back on me. I actually think he saved me a few times. He used to give me a chuckle when we'd have 11-on-11, and Dave Hoffman didn't hit me. He just kind of gave me the look like, that was me, I saved you. So, thank you, Coach. I didn't need too many concussions. Coach Gilby, man, if he didn't come, my career wouldn't have been what it was here at the University of Washington. When I came, we were a two wide receiver set. We didn't really throw the ball. He came, and I was just like a toy to him. But at the same time, he took me in. He made sure that even when we played Washington State, there was a guy calling me a cartoon character. So he put in a special package just so I could be lined up with that guy. Every time I needed something, he made sure that I shined. If it wasn't for him, I definitely wouldn't be here. Another moment. The last two Rose Bowl victories in Washington history, he just happened to be the offensive coordinator, just for the record. Coach James, you know, I just recently missed his the game we had for him and his services because I had bronchitis, and I'm telling you, it was like hurtful to miss it because he wouldn't miss anything, and I just had to come to the realization that he could actually see me from up above and tell that I was sick. So, but missing that experience, I just had to send a shout out to Miss James and tell you how much I love you and Coach. He taught me so much. Never to be late. Actually, never to be on time. You better be early. Coach James is just a wonderful, wonderful person and mean at the same time. He talked to everybody, including the janitor. He had everybody. He knew everybody's name. And just to see him lead a group of men and young men and staff is just one of those amazing things that you don't know in the moment how important it is, but when you look back on it, he's the reason that I'm early and not on time and not late. He's the reason that I now have self-discipline in my life, and he's the reason that I like to give back. There were bets that I would cry, and I'm trying to keep my money, so. I'm gonna thank the most important person. When I came to the University of Washington, I wanted number 5. You know, they gave you those pictures they take on a recruiting trip. They took a picture with my number 5, and you get to hang it up and everything. But when I came in the locker, there was a number 80. So of course, I'm gonna call mom and tell her. And the next day, I had a number 5 in my locker. But I told Coach Lambright, I'm like, man, I don't want it like that. I'm gonna take this 80 and I'm gonna earn my 5. So I stuck with 80 for the year and got 5 the next year. But yes, I am a self-proclaimed mama's boy, and my mother has been everything. I'm not gonna cry. You know, it's working 2 jobs. It's playing like in 100 games. And I remember I had been like almost 100 basketball and football games and she had only missed 1. That love and support, you can't describe anything like that. Coach Baird likes to say I was homesick after a few weeks and I'm the only guy that's 10 minutes away. But, you know, when it's just you and your mom and you're stuck here with 170 guys and they're trying to beat your head off, you know, you might be homesick too. My mother is the most wonderful human being in the world, and I can't thank her enough. So, yeah. Now to my experience here at Washington, it's been one of the greatest experiences in my lifetime. In the moment, I didn't know it was such a great experience. I was just kind of going through the motions. My teammates, I don't know who's here, but Greg, yes, we did beat you your senior year before we came here to Washington. But as a teammate, Greg was inspiring. He was from the local area. He made sure that I was doing what I was supposed to do, that I was working hard, taking care of business. To my coaches that aren't here, Coach James, Coach Corgan, and rest in peace. To the rest of the coaches, Coach Pinkle, Coach Woodruff, all those coaches, they taught me how to give back. They taught me how to be a man. They taught me everything in life that I appreciate today. My teammates were wonderful. I really feel like even though the Seahawks just recently won a championship, I feel like our team was the best team in Washington sports history, and I just happened to be a part of it. A lot of people always ask, well, what happened to you, Mario Bailey, after you struck the Heisman pose? I thought you should have did that and this and this and that. And I tell them, you know, honestly, when I left here, I was just kind of lost. It's like the kid that gets his first apartment. I just didn't apply the lessons that were given to me while I was here at the University of Washington. So I tell them that I didn't work as hard as I was supposed to at the next level. A lot of people like to make excuses and say they were hurt or this coach didn't like me. No, it was my fault. I was having too much fun. I didn't work hard. And I happened to run into Coach Gilbertson when my career was winding down. I played in every FL that you could imagine, the CFL, the XFL, the LLL. Yeah, I had a good career, but I had a good career that was just based on talent. It wasn't based on hard work. Ran into Coach Gilbertson, he's like, you need to come back and finish. He's like, I'm just now growing up. It's time for you to grow up. So went back and got my degree and found out what my passion is. And my passion was, my mother would have killed me if I didn't get the degree. My passion is just giving back to the community. I learned along the way from my mother and all my coaches and friends and family that giving back is the most important thing. So I started my own foundation. We've fed the homeless the last 2 years and we'll be doing it again for this Thanksgiving. We also have a scholarship fund for 5 seniors coming up this year, if you ever want to donate. And I just the experience here of being at the University of Washington has shaped my life. It didn't go right away, right after I left here, but today, being here in front of all of you and speaking, I have my wonderful family here with support, coworkers, friends, my wife. Everybody's here to support me. I'm glad it's not a funeral and I get to see it, actually. So thank you so much. I also have, to piggyback on what Jawarn said earlier, I have a 19-year-old son here who recently told me, "Yeah, Dad, you've done some things, but I'm gonna do more." And you know, to him, "I want you to do more. I want you to be successful. I'm here to guide you along the way, and I love you so much." To everybody here, to all the people that came out to support me, it's greatly appreciated. To Coach Peterson, he sent me a letter, said he couldn't be here. I just wanted to send him a message that who would be a better recruiter than a guy that went to the University of Washington and is down the street if you're trying to get all those Bellevue athletes here. You can send him that message for me. I do have a job, but you know. Shout out to John Otness. I know my mom was stalking you to make sure that I got here today, but you're a wonderful, wonderful human being. I'm happy that you're part of the Big W Club and everybody that got me here. I only put down one quote since I found out that my passion is giving back, and that's from Muhammad Ali. "Is service to others is the rent you pay for your room here on earth." Thank you, and I'm glad to still be here. Go Dawgs.
Wow. I don't know about you, but I got chills. Thank you. Thank you so much. Before we conclude tonight, I would like to invite all of the Hall of Fame members to the stage. Yes, all of you, both past and present, please come forward right now. Let's go. All of you. As they come up here, I have some final words for you. We'd like to thank all of the people who made this Husky Hall of Fame ceremony possible. Special thanks to our presenting sponsor, Airvan. Remember, you can bring home memories of this event. Here's how you do it. It's a DVD. It's produced by UWTV. You will see all the videos on UWTV. You can actually order a DVD. Those forms are available in the reception area or online at uwtv.org. Are we getting everybody up here? There's a room. Now we do, this thing is like strong enough, right? You should. Oh yeah, this is picture time. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome our 2014 Class of the Hall of Fame and all the other wearers of the purple jacket. Pictures, pictures, more pictures. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our event. One couple of final notes for you. You know, when you see me, it always begs a question, so I'll answer it real quickly. Scattered showers tomorrow, high temperatures pretty much in the mid to upper 50s. And get this, it looks like it's probably going to be rainy and windy on Saturday. Just the kind of weather we need to douse out some sun devils, don't you think? All right. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here tonight. God bless you all. Have a great evening, and go Huskies!